Welcome in, everyone, to the 2021 New York Giants Mock Draft 2.0, the not-so-early edition. I'm kidding. I'm calling it the not-so-early edition because it actually has a lot in common with my Mock Draft 1.0 way-too-early edition because, to be honest with you guys, everything after the first round of this Mock Draft is still an unknown. It is still a complete shot in the dark, still realistically a crapshoot. Still, even though we now know the order of the draft picks and where teams will be picking, the needs of each team are not as clear as where they're picking. Of course, that has a lot to do with the fact that free agency has not occurred yet, but I digress, we are here anywhere, and I will try to address as many needs that the Giants have, and we do have a lot with the six picks that we currently got, and based off of the feedback from Mock Draft 1.0, you guys are wanting me to take more than one weapon this time, so I will try to do that as well. I guess we're just going to assume that the positions I did not get to take during this draft were either tackled in free agency or were somehow filled another way. It is kind of difficult to get all of them with just six picks. With that being said, let's get into it. With the 11th pick in the 2021 NFL Draft, the New York Giants select Jalen Waddle, wide receiver, Alabama. Alright, so yes, I still wholeheartedly believe that one of these top three receivers will be available for the Giants to pick at 11th overall in this draft. Now, not so much anymore about Ja'Marr Chase. I think he is probably going to go in the top 10 for sure. But I really do think either Jalen Waddle or Devontae Smith, who was the guy mocked to us in the last draft, that they're one of these guys is going to be available there. And it completely fills the need that we have. I mean, wide receiver right now is the most important need for the Giants on the offensive side of the ball. And right now we need to use this offseason to fix the offensive side of the ball. And if Jalen Waddle is there at 11, it's an absolute no-brainer. I've been a guy that thinks wide receiver is the way to go. And he is somebody that is absolutely perfect for the New York Giants. Let's get into him. Standing at 5'10 and 182 pounds, if there's one thing that anybody looking at this draft knows about Jalen Waddle, is that he has game-breaking speed to beat NFL defenses. Waddle is so fast and agile on the field that not many defenders can keep up with him, and causes him to consistently split defenses when he's out there running on the field. And when they have double teams on him, he consistently splits the double team as well and wins his matchups. One thing people seem to forget about Jalen Waddle is that entering the 2020 season and for like the first three games of the 2020 season, he was Alabama's number one receiver. In those three games, he had 28 receptions for 591 yards and 4 touchdowns in just 3 games. Of course, he went down with a fractured ankle against Tennessee, and his season ended right there. Devontae Smith came in, he had the responsibility of being the number one, and he took the ball and ran with it. Heisman winning season, all that is great, but just based off of those three games, you know what Jalen Waddle was, and you have three seasons of him at Alabama showing us what he was. You know, he was being rotated in their massive wide receiver core there, and he was always making an impact. You could only imagine what he would have done with a full college football season. But to get off the stats and get back to what he is an extremely tough player. And despite his height, which isn't even that short, I mean, 5'10 is a good height, a great height for an NFL wide receiver. For some reason, people see it as a con. It really is not. Even if it is, the dude has a background in basketball for a reason. He has an amazing vertical, and several times, many times during his career at Alabama, he could go up and catch any high-pointed ball thrown his way. And when he goes up, he comes down with it. He has one of the best pair of hands in college football, much like what I said about his teammate Devontae Smith. And he's more fundamentally sound than Smith, in my opinion. He's one of the most fundamentally sound players, maybe not named Ja'Marr Chase, playing this position. Whenever he catches the ball, he always, and I mean always, tucks it away and secures it away from the defender to prevent them from trying to knock it out, cause a fumble, cause an incompletion. If Jalen Waddle gets his hand on the ball, he's coming down with it and he's keeping it. His route running ability is absolutely spectacular. It's just so smooth and crisp. He's great at utilizing his body to fake out defenders. and keeping them on their toes. And just off of his route running alone, he has won many matchups. But even if there is a good defensive back out there that does a good job keeping up with him, that's where the game-breaking speed just comes in, and it's absolutely no match. You can play this guy literally anywhere on the field and he's gonna succeed, and that's one of the main reasons he's gonna be so good as a number one receiver for the New York Giants. And there's not really any real negatives that I could say about Jalen Waddle. I mean, the only thing I'm concerned about is his fractured ankle. I'm wondering if it's gonna heal properly and if it's a sign for other injuries, but other than that, he's almost a perfect prospect. With the 42nd pick in the 2021 NFL Draft, the New York Giants select Chaz Surratt, linebacker, UNC. Standing at 6'2", 225 pounds, Chaz Surratt is simply a perfect fit for the New York Giants. I'm talking match made in heaven if he's available and we do select him. Of course, we are looking for that linebacker number two next to Blake Martinez, and to have one of the better linebacking cores in the league. If we take Surratt, you could wrap it up as possibly one of the elite linebacking cores in the league. This guy originally went to UNC to become a quarterback from them during his first 2 years there, but then switched to linebacker his junior year, and the results was astounding. In that 2019 season, he had 115 total tackles, 66 solo, with 6.5 sacks, 1 forced fumble, with the fumble recovery and an interception. As a player in his first year in that position, that is unheard of. And I already like players, I really do like players that were once quarterbacks and then switched to the defensive side of the ball, because it's almost like they have an inside look as to how quarterbacks in general thinks. And you can see this on the field with Chaz Surratt sometimes, man. The dude is an extremely instinctual player. At times, so much so that he just looks like he's thinking at another level compared to his teammates and compared to his fellow linebackers, for sure. It's what's led to him being one of the better linebackers in this year's draft, at diagnosing things like screens and making the correct decisions in zone coverage, you know, knowing which weapon, which wide receiver, which tight end to go and cover. The football IQ is 100% there. I mean, it has to be there for you to at one point be a quarterback, switching over to basically what is the quarterback of the defense. It just shows really well, and that's not even his best trait. The thing that a lot of people know about Chaz Surratt is that he's insanely athletic and he plays really fast on the field too. And with those two traits, there's almost a third one that he has that not many players that are really great athletes have, and that's playing with a sense of urgency, and Chaz Surratt does have that. His burst, his twitchiness, he's very fluid in his hips, the size to Zion range, it's led to him just being an all-around explosive player, and this is what's led to him being a really good pass defender as well, with a great ability to break on the ball and close out gaps. Now, it doesn't always work, because when you're playing at 110%, sometimes he overshoots, sometimes he oversells. You know, it can come as a knock that, you know, he's just too aggressive on the field, but it works out more often than not, and it's a very fixable mistake. It's not even that big of a problem. Oh yeah, and by the way, this guy can 100% cover tight end, so you don't have to worry about that either. And just because he's good in the pass doesn't mean he's not good in the run. He's effective in the run game as well. The range certainly comes in hands with dealing with running backs, and he's really good at getting down to the line of scrimmage and closing off any running lanes. Now, some people may look at his 2020 season where he posted 91 total tackles, 49 solo, 6 sacks, 1 fumble with the recovery and another interception as kind of a step down, even though for the most part he posted the similar stats in less games. But that was because they shifted him to more of a leader of the defensive side of the ball, where he was actually like the Mike linebacker. And while he was good at that, he's certainly best at just being on his own and just relying on his instincts to do his job. And since we already have our Mike guy in Blake, Chaz just slides right in. With the 76th pick in the 2021 NFL Draft, the New York Giants select Paulson Adebo, cornerback, Stanford. Now, this pick, along with the previous one in Chaz Surratt, are both players that could go around the second or third round. That's what they're thought to be as of right now, second and third round players. And to be honest with you, you could really switch the placement of them. For example, you could have a mock where Paulson Adebo goes in the second and then the Giants take Chaz Surratt in the third, and it would make perfect sense. It really would. Like, I think you could switch these players up and it would be no problem at all. But to speak on Adebo, he's a very interesting prospect, because at one point during last season, he was considered one of the top corners, maybe even the top corner, to enter the 2020 draft. I'm talking about alongside the likes of CJ Henderson and, of course, Jeff Okuda. Now, that was, of course, before he committed to go back to Stanford and go back to school and have another year of play. mostly his own decision was to try and clean up any sloppiness. Standing at 6'1", 190 pounds, Paulson Adebo was built to be an outside boundary corner in the NFL, and it is really his physical attributes that stand out the most when you take a look at this guy. He has the height, weight, and even though there's no official measurement of it yet, a pretty good wingspan to use in the NFL. He's always using that wingspan to bat balls down in the air, to force an incompletion, say, you know, the wide receiver catches it, but he makes sure that it doesn't stay in that wide receiver's hands as they make their way to the ground, and even to force fumbles every now and then. Then there is, of course, the best thing he does with that wingspan, that is get interceptions. And even though he did not play in the 2020 season, he did opt out. Over the course of the 2018 and 2019 season, a very impressive resume with 97 tackles, 5 for loss, 8 interceptions, and 27 passes defended. I'm gonna say that again, 27 passes defended. I know the 8 interceptions is pretty impressive, but I find the amount of passes defending even more so. And he has what you want in any NFL defender. Nice fluid hips, pretty good lateral agility and mobility, and a solid speed to keep up with most wide receivers. His length really comes in handy in press coverage situations, and he knows how to use his hands well there. And he has a good discipline to know to stay in his lane and stay in his position before fully committing to someone at the line of scrimmage. And a word on that discipline, it's good, not great. He can be overly aggressive sometimes. He can turn a little bit too early sometimes. And he could be definitely fooled by double moves, but this is all fixable mistakes. You know, it's not like he has tunnel vision or anything. In fact, he rarely ever has tunnel vision, but definitely fixable mistake. And Paulson Adebo is a cornerback. If we take, remember at one point how highly regarded he was, he will be a great, excellent number two corner for the Giants. With the 999th pick in the 2021 NFL Draft, the Hub selects Manscaped Lawnmower 3.0 and Perfect Package 3.0. All right, guys, so as you well know, support for the Hub and for this video is brought to you by Manscaped, the best in men's below-the-waist grooming. Manscaped.com offers precision-engineered tools to take care of your family jewels. This is going to be a good pickup because they obsess over their technological developments to provide you with the best grooming experience. It is going to be unmatched compared to any other pick in this draft right here. Manscaped is trusted by over 2 million men worldwide, and they got an exclusive offer for you guys, for my listeners, 20% off and free shipping with the code HUB, H-U-B at manscaped.com. Already coming in clutch, and they're not even seeing the field yet. Manscaped. With the 116th pick in the 2021 NFL Draft, the New York Giants select Ronnie Perkins, Edge, Oklahoma. Now here we see a familiar face that I actually had in the previous mock draft, also as our fourth pick. Of course, then I had the wrong number pick that the Giants had. I thought that we were missing a fourth, not a fifth. I got it correct this time. Either way, Ronnie Perkins, perfect versatile guy for this Giants defense, for Patrick Graham, and he's going to be available around the fourth anyway. Somebody that could play both standing upright as an outside linebacker, and that could play in the five technique on the defensive line. He stands at 6'3", 247 pounds, and the weight, by the way, I just want to put out there, kind of hard to find a legitimate consensus on. Some websites are saying 247, some are saying 248, I've seen some saying 250. He's a big dude. Like, so if he was to play a stand-up outside linebacker, which once again he can, he'd be a big power outside linebacker, kind of a bull rusher, and that shows when he gets into his pass rushing technique. Now real quick, he did finish out this 2020 season at Oklahoma with 16 tackles, 5.5 sacks. Some of you might look at that and say not too impressive. Well, he is being taken in the fourth round, but I can see the potential here, and that's kind of going to be the talk of the town for the fourth round and beyond with any draft pick. Perkins in particular is all about the explosiveness off the edge and hitting those linemen with his power. He's a dude that loves to impose his will onto the offensive linemen. He loves to force them into their backfield. That's what his name of the game is all about. That first strong hand, and which he does, by the way, have, you know, pretty lengthy arms in my opinion. From that first burst, just converting that into the power and pushing these guys back, that's his main move. He's all about pulling, ripping, pushing. And the thing is, it's been pretty good throughout his college years. He's also really aggressive in the run game. That's not to say that he's necessarily great in the run game. He's just not afraid to get into the backfield, or not afraid to try and track down where the running back is and try and tackle them. And this dude's been double teamed, you know, quite a bit over there at Oklahoma. Like, they've used him in stunts. You know, his lateral quickness is just good enough even for stunts. He takes on double teams well. There's a lot of good when you look at Ronnie Perkins. He's a guy that really could develop as a great pass rusher that's also really good in the run defense. Of course, once again, fourth round, he only has that power move. He needs to develop something else at the NFL level because that one move is not going to cut it. He definitely needs to come up with something else to try and get to the quarterback. And he definitely needs to learn how to be a bit more flexible. With the 198th pick in the 2021 NFL draft, the New York Giants select Warren Jackson, wide receiver, Colorado State. Before I say anything else, let me just tell you guys that this guy, Warren Jackson, is absolutely massive. He stands at 6'6", listed at 215 pounds, giving him more than elite size for the position. And that is where all his strengths lie in, right? And it's not exactly too terrible for a sixth round receiver to have his strengths in his size. He's obviously a complete matchup problem for defensive backs, and there's not many that could get the jump on him or force an incompletion on him, especially if you just allow him to use that size, use that height, use the wingspan, use the weight to just bully a defensive back, or, you know, high point it a little bit. Unless that back has insane vertical hops, he's not really going to have the advantage on Warren Jackson. And his size comes with a pretty good catch radius as well. That's not to say he's catching every single ball that goes up there. In fact, the ones he does drop are all focus catches, though. It's like, you know, you turn your head too quickly, or you're focusing on the yards after the catch before you completely secure it. It's completely fixable. No matter what team he goes to, he's going to be a quarterback-friendly target just because of his size. And of course, that means he's going to be a really good red zone threat and somebody you're going to want to use in the 25-yard line. That doesn't mean he could only be used there. Because he's so good at winning 50-50 balls, once again, because of just his size, he will have success on some deep passes if he gets open a little bit. But make no mistake, you're going to be most comfortable using him in goal line situations. And Jackson is somebody that really improved in his junior year, logging in 77 catches for 1,119 yards and 8 touchdowns. Absolutely massive improvement from his previous 2 years, where he had 405 yards and before that 265 yards, respectively. Other than just improving as a receiver, another thing he improved that in that junior year was blocking. Beforehand, if you were to look at him, say, in 2017, 2018, he didn't really look like he was putting much effort into it. But in 2019, it greatly improved. It still has a long way to go, as does a lot of his areas right now. But the effort is there. It showed that in the offseason he put in work and he was trying to become a better player for his team. Of course, he's a sixth round player, so there is quite a bit to improve, but the potential is there. Like I said before, that's what's going to come down to with these guys. For example, he needs to be a bit more quick. He needs to be more agile, certainly needs to be more flexible. He's a bit stiff, which is understandable at his height, but he's going to need to improve in that, and he needs to improve his game a little bit more in terms of receptions and yards after the catch. Once he catches the ball, not really the best at getting anything extra. But considering what he does offer, and especially that size where we're getting him, I would love to have Jackson on this team if he were to be picked up in the sixth round. With the 203rd pick in the 2021 NFL draft, the New York Giants select Cole Van Lannen, offensive tackle, Wisconsin. Now, I said it in my last mock as well, I really do want to get a little bit of offensive line depth here. Of course, I did sacrifice offensive guard depth for the sake of taking a wide receiver, but I'm still going to get a tackle later on in the rounds there. It's completely necessary, and you don't want to forget about the offensive line. We're going to need good depth moving into the season, and Van Lannen is exactly that, good depth, right? In the sixth round, you're not expecting somebody to be a starter, but you're expecting them to be a good rotational player and good backup, right? Van Lannen is absolutely that. In fact, he's shown potential before. At one point in 2018, he was so good, he was considered one of the nation's best tackles a couple of seasons ago. Of course, with more and more seasons, usual as players do, and as, you know, the college football season goes, you know, they calm down a little bit, they rise, they fall. In this case, Van Lannen fell, but not too much. He's still an absolute beast coming off the line of scrimmage, and power is the name of the game when it comes to him. If he gets a forward push on any defender, it's usually over for them and he would have control. He's going to be a pretty good offensive lineman when it comes to the run game at the next level, which is of course something I'm looking at, considering that's the kind of team that the Giants want to be right now. And his size, which I didn't even mention yet, is really good for an offensive tackle standing at 6'5", 312 pounds. He would be an absolute monster if he continues to be as good as he is in the power game. All in all, if there was one word I'd use to describe him, it'd be effective. You know, he gets the job done. It's not exactly always the prettiest of jobs, though. And of course, there are cons. Comes with being around these rounds. He needs to improve his footwork a lot. Like I mentioned before, it's all fine and dandy once he's pushing forward and he got that advantage. Otherwise, it's kind of sloppy. Sometimes he overextends, sometimes there's too many steps, and that leads to him being a bit stiff in the hips as well, which means he's not the best against speed rushers, but thankfully, he's gonna be somebody that's gonna, you know, definitely see the rounds with the practice squad, definitely see the rounds with the backup team and whatnot, and hopefully that leads to improvement. Once again, the potential is there considering where he was just a couple of years ago, so it's not like the guy's a complete scrub. There you have it. There is mock draft 2.0 with picks influenced by the feedback that you guys left on the mock draft 1.0 last month. As you can see, a lot of work went into this one as well. I want to first and foremost give a shout out to Farhan. You guys already know him. He's helped me make a lot of stuff on the channel. This would not have been possible without him. And on the mock draft moving forward with 3.0 actually, I'm going to kind of go back to mocking who I really think I would want to take in these picks should those prospects stay where they are right now. But the next time the mock comes out, it's going to be after free agency begins, so that's going to be extremely fun. Put your thoughts down below, let me know what you think, and I'm out.